بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على رسوله الأمين سيدنا محمد النبي الصادق الوعد الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطيبين الطاهرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وأنت خير الفاتحين. أما بعد، respected elders, brothers, boys and girls, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Just fixing this mic. Subhanallah. I missed you. Sorry, I couldn't make it last week. Because I was moving house, I moved to Newlands. So unfortunately, currently I don't live in Kilburnie, but inshallah, I'm trying my best to come home. Inshallah. I know kids are very excited tonight, mashallah. They will have dinner and they will stay up. They don't have to go to bed early. I know when kids at home is very challenging for parents. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take the best care of our children, Allahumma ameen, and raise them in the best of manners, inshallah. I have so many things I would like to talk about tonight. But again, I have one thing ahead of me that stopped me from going forward, which is time. I don't have much time. I know that I have to finish quickly to give you enough time for dinner and also give time for families to rest. But also, I'm not going to do like this guy in a very remote village in a Muslim country back in the time. This village has only one masjid and one only imam. One imam and one masjid. So the imam passed away suddenly. And they didn't know what to do. So they went to the chief of the village and they said, we don't have an imam now. He passed away. Who's going to give the khutbah for us? He picked up one of the people, one of the crowd, who looks smart and vocal. And he said, you are the imam. He said, what? I never give a khutbah before. He said, no, you're going to give the khutbah next week. Done. Decision already made. Have no way out. He thought about it. SubhanAllah, I can't do that. What can I do? So Friday, stand up. He asked the people, do you know what I'm going to talk about? They said, no, I don't know. He said, I'm not going to waste my time with ignorant people who don't know anything. He got angry and he left. He didn't give the khutbah. The people got together and started blaming themselves. It's our fault. We upset our new imam. Next time, we have to tell him that we know everything. So next Friday, he came, stand up. He said, do you know what I'm going to talk about? He said, yes, we know. He said, okay. If this is the case, I don't have to repeat myself again. You already know everything. And he left. Do you know what I'm going to talk about? Yes or no? In both cases, I'm not going to leave anyway. First thing, I received a motion from the brothers here that we are in a very bad need. Aman Muslim community is in a very bad need to expand. That's true. We all grow bigger. But we need to think carefully before we take any step forward. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to be very careful and to take our time to think. And I'm not going to speak much about it, but I just need you guys, especially those people in the decision-making kitchen, to think before they make any decision. But generally speaking, every community in the world grow bigger. If you go to Mecca or Medina, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the opportunity to go for Hajj, Allahumma. It's our dream. You expect that there is only one masjid there. But to your surprise, there are plenty of masajid in Mecca, plenty of masajid in Medina. Even at the time of Rasulullah, there were six masajid working full time. Five times prayer full time working. You know? They were working side by side with Rasulullah's masjid, the best masjid in Medina. 1,000 salah for each and every salah you perform in the Medina masjid. But still, people have need, were in need to have other like branches of al-Nabawi, masjid al-Nabawi, around Medina. So that's the first motion. The second point is, you know, I was also asking about the halal food and going to the you know, a restaurant and takeaways, because this is holiday time, and you know, families plan to go out for dinner. They have plenty of time. They don't know how to spend this time. And instead of donating the time to a man center, they go for dinner. You better just donate the money and eat at home anyway. But anyway, let's imagine that people have options to go out and have dinner out. So they ask about what is halal and what is haram. I will tell you, if you go to a place where they serve alcohol or they allow the customers to come with their alcohol, then you're not supposed to eat and dine in this place. Because a Muslim is not allowed to be present where people are drinking alcohol. If you are in a place that you have an option to be there or not to be there, then you don't have to be there. You're not allowed to be there. Rasulullah ﷺ cursed those people who drink alcohol, and those people who serve alcohol, and those people who manufacture alcohol, and those people who sit in a place where people are, you know, drinking alcohol. I said, if you have the option, but if it's in your workplace and you have no other option, you have to be there, then you have to be there, right? But going to a restaurant, particular restaurant that serve alcohol or allow the customer to come with their beers, then you shouldn't go to these places. Mashallah, jazakallah khairan, brother. Time to sleep. Bedtime, guys. Subhanallah. Okay, so that's one thing. If you are not sure whether the food is served there is halal or not halal, you know, some brands of chicken are not certified halal or certified by an authorized certifier, then my advice to you, like my advice as somebody who work in this field, in the halal auditing, in the manufacturing of foods, then you better stay away. Because I'm telling you very honestly and very straightforward, all the factories here in New Zealand, and probably somewhere else in the world, I'm not sure, but I'm talking about the factories here, they provide halal or they manufacture halal, not because they love the halal or because this is part of their belief, they want to make everything halal, or they don't want to upset Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they manufacture halal. Nothing of that. It's all business. It's all business because they make money from halal. But they don't believe at all in this halal thing. They don't believe in it. If somebody comes tomorrow and offer double the price to the same manufacturer, they're going to kick the halal guys to neck out of the factory straight away. And they will say, no, you're not going to go do any halal anymore. What? So it's all for them a matter of money. So we trust them as long as they need to manufacture halal. Once they are in no need, they're going to turn it the other way around. That's it. Full stop. Why? Because that is not part of their belief. That is not the part of their faith. They do it just because of business. They make more money out of it. So they will try every single thing to maximize their profit, whether it is halal or not halal. So you have to be really very careful and don't just trust any piece of paper that has a stamp that says halal. It doesn't necessarily mean it is halal. It could be a home or office printer that made this fabricated logo. You don't trust that. You have to make sure that it's really, truly halal. If you have any doubt, then Rasulullah ﷺ made it clear. He said, Al-halalu bayin wal-haramu bayin. Halal is clear, al-haram is clear. And in between, some doubtful matter. Not everyone knows about them. So only specialized people or people of knowledge who are aware of that. What does it mean? I have to ask. I can't just go forward and say, okay, man, just take it easy, just food. You see? No. If you don't know, not sure, you have to ask. If you couldn't ask, then you can't do that. You can't just go and eat and enjoy. Not because your kids put pressure on you and said, no, we need to eat McDonald's. We need to eat KFC. We need to eat this. We love to do that. Okay, fine. Let's just make sure it is halal for us to eat. If it's not halal, then no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ولا تأكلوا مما لم يذكر اسم الله عليه وإنه لفسق. He said, do not eat something that Allah's name is not mentioned on it, because it is fisq. It is something great, major sin. It's not an easy thing. It's not just, we don't just go out and fill our stomach and enjoy the taste and that's it, all what we're looking for. No. No, we can't do that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّ جَسَدٍ نَبَتَ مِنْ حَرَامٍ فَالنَّارَ أَوْلَى بِهِ. If you nourish your body from haram food, whether it is because the money you use is haram or the food itself is haram, is not halal, then the only way to purify this body on the judgment day is to burn it down in the hellfire. The only way to go is the hellfire, no other way. Somebody came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, why do I ask Allah but He never accepts my dua?" He said, "Look, there is one thing you have to do. أطب مطعمك تكون مستجاب الدعوة. Eat halal, your dua will be accepted. That's it. Full stop. So if you have some issue about your dua and you don't think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is answering your dua, the first checkout point is my food, my dietary. Do I eat halal? Do I earn halal? If this is the case, then your dua will be accepted. No question asked. If not, then no matter what you do, what you try to do, your dua will not be accepted. Allah, you have already blocked the channel with your haram food, so your dua has no way to access or to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Will not be answered, subhanallah. So that is another thing, is, you know, food and dietaries and dining, go and enjoy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a lot of things for us to enjoy. But first and foremost, you need to make sure this is halal. Before you feed your children, before you feed yourself and your families. I know kids have, you know, a lot of ways to put pressure on their dad, you know. And they said, "Oh, dad, you have to do that." And started crying and screaming, and we feel weak and helpless. And we say, "Okay, ya astaghfirullah, I'm going to do that." He says, "Astaghfirullah." Like this guy who wants to rob a house. And before going to the rob a house, he said, "Should I go 1 p.m., 1 a.m., or 2 a.m.?" And then he called his friend, the same working the same field, you know, house robber. He said, "Should I go 8 a.m.?" He said, "Man, go and salat al-istikhara, man, you know. Go and do istikhara, Allah will tell you. Tell God." You're going to do something haram, you see. So that is something that we have to teach our kids. The other thing, brothers and elders, our relationship with the people. That's another issue. I raised it throughout my khutbas in the last month. We live with non-Muslims, alhamdulillah. This is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it gives us an opportunity to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our actions before we call to Allah with our words. Actions are louder than words. See? So as a Muslim, you are placed in this place because Allah wants you here. Don't think that you come here because you have a lot of points that qualifies you to come to this country, or because I am a refugee and you have to come here. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala carefully placed you here. Whether you are from, you know, migrants or people who migrated before you, whoever is here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you here. Because you are here to speak on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and on behalf of Rasulullah. So be careful when you speak on behalf of Allah. Do not sell Islam out for cheap. Islam is very expensive. So you live here, you have to stand, you know, have to stand confident of yourself. You have to stand confident of yourself. And don't just follow the trend. People do something, just I do, they're like them. It's okay. You see, the biggest Christmas tree in the world that cost $180 million. $180 million. Where is it? It is not in the Vatican. It's not in Vatican. Vatican don't celebrate Christmas anyway. You know what? Where is it? It is in Dubai, in a Muslim country. You see? This is the biggest Christmas tree. Why? Because, you know, it doesn't mean that, you know, the man has or the people have Muslim flag or whatever, they are practicing Islam properly. You know, it was for the seven centuries a prohibited celebration. And from the writing of the rabbis and from the priestess, the original, you know, preachers of Christianity and the original books of authentic books of Christianity, they said it's a prohibited pagan celebration. The Christmas tree is a pagan tree. The star on the top of the tree is a pagan practice. Celebrating the person day is a pagan practice. So they made it prohibited until even 1864, and it was prohibited in America until 1946. Just 50, 70 years ago, prohibited, illegal. And just people follow the trend, subhanallah. Why? Because something to do with politics. And another thing that you have to learn as Muslims, this is not negativity. This is not pessimism. This is reality. Because the reality you can get from your knowledge is from the Quran. All other sort of knowledges have question marks. You can't trust everything around you. But the one you trust, the source of knowledge that you can trust for sure is the Holy Quran, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you read carefully, and that's our problem, we don't read properly. If we read the writing of the scientists who have great achievements, they will tell you clearly that we are not sure of what we have, you know, written down. We just assume that we are telling the truth. But that is not the truth. That is not truth. This is just a theory. Somebody is going to come tomorrow and say, this is a wrong theory. This is not right. But the ultimate truth, the unquestionable truth is the book of Allah and the messenger, the sunnah of Rasulullah. This is the ilm, the right ilm. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us, that he said this world is going to be full of corruption. And the humans will not be sure of anything. They will be unsure of anything. They will be so confused. And this is a must. This has to happen before the arrival of Dajjal. Dajjal is going to come to earth at some stage, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing the earth to receive a Dajjal. Not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is allowing things to happen. And don't think we are the only nation or the only faith who believe in the Dajjal. No. There are a lot of people, almost every religion, but it's not announced. They believe in the arrival of Dajjal. And so many of these religions, especially, any religion that connect man with God, they say human man or human God, that man and God are the same thing, or they are, you know, they replace each other, or they work together, like Christianity, Hinduism, Sikh, and so many other religions that claim that God and creation are same thing. All of these religions are working hard for a Dajjal to arrive. You know why? Because their scriptures tell them that the time is going to come that the one what we're going to worship is Shaitan. They are preparing to increase the worship of Shaitan. And the first step for people to worship the Shaitan is to become atheists. Because you deny God and then you replace God with another God. But you can't say straight away God is a Shaitan. You can't do that. So this is what they are trying to do. They are trying to present two concepts or two ideas. Are you still awake? I'm talking about very, very complicated. You see, the first idea is to introduce the idea of a superman, which is the man God. So the one who can have the qualities of God. And you can see that is something that is, you know, that has become very popular now. The second thing is to introduce the concept of a robotic man. Man that has some electronic capacity or that has some chips that can do things, you know, like a robot, so they can live longer and they can endure a lot of challenges, and they have the quality of a robot, of a machine, of a computer, and the same side the qualities of human being. So when they introduce those two ideas, they believe that the Shaitan is going to present himself in a human form and is going to come to rule the world. This is exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, that the Dajjal is going to come, and when the Dajjal is going to come, most of humans are going to follow him and worship him as God. And it's not going to happen over the night. They have to prepare the humanity for that. For this to happen, they have to play a lot with the religion of the people. First, break the identity of each religion. So they allow so many things. They allow so many things that were prohibited in the religion. Like homosexuality, for example. It is intentionally made or forced on the life of the people because of what? Because this is one of the ways that Shaitan or the Dajjal is going to come to earth. And this is what they are looking for. This is what they are looking for. And that's why you need to be careful. You need to be very careful, and you need to look after your kids, because they face a lot of challenges. Don't be confident that your kids will grow Muslims just because you are a Muslim. They are ready to lose their religion very quickly. They are very ready to be atheists. They are educated to be atheists. And this is the first step for them. to worship the shaitan, and this is the first step, or this has to happen before the arrival of Dajjal. And Dajjal has to come. And because Dajjal has to come, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised it will come, and Rasulullah said it will be, he will come, that these preparation steps have to take place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from the fitna of a Dajjal. Rasulullah said, there was not a prophet who come to earth unless he warned his nation from the fitna of a Dajjal. He warned his nation. Even Nuh alayhi salam, see how far he was, thousands of years ago. But he warned his people, he said, be careful. Dajjal might come at any time, and if he comes while you are alive, I can't guarantee that he is going to dissuade you and take you away from Islam. And that will be no return. That will be no return. You can't return it back. Subhanallah. So this is something, it's not being, I'm trying to be very positive. I don't want to be negative or pessimist. But this is the reality. We have to be prepared for the worst. We have to be prepared for the worst. But you have to have hope as well. Today I was one of the popular shops. And I saw, like, you know, a packet of dolls. You know, these dollies that, you know, sold for the kids. Two of these toys have the, you know, family representation. They have maquettes or dollies to represent family. Two examples presented in the shop only. Two examples only. You know what these are examples? Two men and two kids. Two women and two kids. This is a family. This is a family that they... So if your child pick up one of those families, is going to ask you, Dad, this is family. Why mom is here? Where is my other dad? You see, this is here. It's not far away. It is here. Go and search online about Russia. One of the densely populated country. This is the only Western country I know of that prohibit the homosexual. It's prohibited. It is prohibited. It is illegal. You know why? Because they believe, according to the authentic scripture of Christianity, that if this has happened, then the Dajjal is going to show up. So they want to save their countries from a Dajjal. Subhanallah. They want to save him from the Dajjal. So this is how they do it. This is how far they believe in the, you know, arrival of a Dajjal. So yeah, you know, don't give up your deen, don't break it down, and don't sell it for free and say, look, I mean, I have to just, you know, follow the trend. I should have a Christmas tree in my home. I should celebrate these occasions. And you don't know. You have to stand firm. You have to stand firm. Celebrating birthdays have been mentioned in the Bible. You know, the Bible is so big. One of the priests said, I don't remember his name, but he said in the Encyclopedia Britannica, he said, only two people celebrated their birthdays in the Bible. Only two people. The first one was Fir'aun, celebrated his birthday. And the second one was a Numrud, who challenged Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Two dictators who claimed to be gods. Each one of them claimed to be Allah. And those are the only people celebrated their birthdays. None of the prophets celebrated their birthdays. None of the followers of the prophet celebrated their birthdays. And they celebrated their birthdays for one reason. The two celebrate their birthday by confirming or convincing the people that this is the time when God is born inside of me. Now, guys, I am your God. The same idea that came to the Christianity, the man God. The same idea that is there in any other religion, that man and God are the same. They just, like, you know, exchange their presence in some way or form. And we are bringing up to our families and to our communities the same kind of pagan celebration, the birthdays. And we know for sure that, you know, 1 year of gone of my life, I should cry. You see, I should cry. Imagine you have, you know, subhanAllah, you have, you know, $10-$15 in your pocket, and this is the only money you have until you get to your destination. And every time you lose $1, you start feeling panicking. Man, I'm lost. You know, how can I reach my destination? And if you see somebody with you in the same scenario, and every time he lose $1, he starts laughing and enjoying and making, man, are you stupid? Are you idiot? You already lost your means of transportation. I mean, this is your sustenance. This is the way of your life. I mean, this is the source of your life. And every time you lose Some of it you celebrate and you enjoy, you should be upset, subhanAllah. But we turn things upside down. We just follow the trend. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, I mentioned that in the khutbah, the day before yesterday, Allah said to Rasulullah, وَإِنْ تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضُلُّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَإِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ لَفَاسِقُونَ أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ فَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حُكْمًا لِقَوْمٍ يُوقِنُونَ. He said, if you trust the majority of the people and take their advice, you will go astray. Because the majority are wrong. The majority are wrong. Find in the Quran, find in the Sunnah, find even in the Bible, if you read the Bible, find one single example that the Muslims were majority at any time. They never been majority. They never. Never. And they will never be majority. They will never be majority. Even now, when we have 1.6 billion Muslims, as we say, we are the second biggest religion in the world. Well, fine. Are you sure that this 1.6 billion are Muslims? Or Muslims, Muslims? Or fake Muslims, or what, half Muslim? What do you think? Rasulullah said, افترقت اليهود على 73 فرقة وافترقت النصارى على 72 فرقة وتفترق أمتي على 74 فرقة كلهم في النار إلا واحد. He said, the Christians divided into 72 groups, and the Jewish community, divided into 73 groups, and my ummah will be divided into 74 groups. 73 of them will go to the hellfire, and one group will go to the Jannah. Where is the majority now? He said, Muslims, my ummah, will be 74 groups. One group will go to the Jannah, and the rest will not. They said, tell us, who are those people? Which group is it? He said, ma alayhi ana wa ashabi. Those people who follow me and my companions. Follow me, that I follow the way of Rasulullah ﷺ and the way the Sahaba of Rasulullah ﷺ lived. This is how they understood the Quran, and this is how I should understand the Quran. This is how they practiced the Quran, and this is how we should practice the Quran. Did the companions of Rasulullah ﷺ celebrate Christmas?
No.
Did they celebrate the birthday of Rasulullah? No. Did they celebrate their own birthdays? No, they didn't do that. Did they congratulate others and say Merry Christmas? No, they didn't do that. Did they have Christians and Jewish in their community? Yes, they do. But why they didn't do that? Because this is not part of their deen. This is not part of their deen. This is not their faith. And this is not what Rasulullah ﷺ has done. So the only group of Muslims who will go straight away to the Jannah safe are those people who are strangers. And this is what Rasulullah ﷺ said, Tuba lil ghuraba. The Jannah is, Tuba here means that it's the Jannah. The Jannah is for the ghuraba, for the stranger. He said in the beginning of the hadith, Bada al-Islamu ghariban wa sayaudu ghariban. This is a very important hadith that the scholars of the past dedicated big writing, huge amount of their time to write about this. He said, Islam has started something strange, and it will become strange again. Unfamiliar, people will look as strange. Subhanallah. Look at this man who has a broom on his face. I mean, don't you men have a shaving machine? Why do you let this grow? I mean, this is a sunnah of Rasulullah. Why you cover your head, man? Do you want to hide your ugly hair? No, this is a sunnah of Rasulullah. Why do you still kick the ground with your head? This is my prayer. I don't kick the ground anyway. Why do you do this? Because this is the haqq. This is not the strange. This is the truth. He said, Islam has started something strange. And when Rasulullah ﷺ started to call the people to one God, worship only one God, one authority, one source of legislation, one source of law, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did they say? أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عُجَابٌ. What crazy man he is. You know what I mean? All the gods. So we invested in our goods, now we have 316 goods, man. And he will bring us back again to only one, subhanallah, and we lose our investment. Sound is a good idea, right? No. I was hearing from somebody presenting Hinduism. He said, we have up to 300 million gods, Allahu Akbar. How can you count their names? Which one you believe in? Everyone is God. Okay, fine. Go ahead. Enjoy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala When Islam started, when Allah Rasulullah started calling people, they said this is something strange, unfamiliar. This is something unheard of, unthinkable. He said, بَدَى الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا. It will become something strange again. Something strange. You will look strange. People will look at you with, give you a strange look. He said, what this man is? Why he doesn't look at, like, why his woman is covered? Why he is doing that? Why he is, so fussy about halal and haram? Why he is doing this? What? People will start questioning you, and if you feel embarrassed because you are a Muslim and you want to hide away and you don't want to show the people that you are a Muslim, it means that you have something wrong. You feel that there is something wrong in this deed, but there is nothing wrong. We have nothing to apologize from or to apologize about. Our deen is the truth, and the truth is the truth. أَفَمَنْ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْحَقِّ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُتَّبَعَ أَمَّنْ لَا يَهِدِّي. Who has the right to be followed? The one who called the truth and the one who called the falsehood. Which one you should follow? The one who called you out for the Jannah or the one who called you out for Jahannam? Rasulullah ﷺ said, my example and the example of the people is like somebody who set out a fire and the moss and the insects and the butterflies start coming and falling into the fire. And I keep pushing them away, but they force me and jump into the fire. This is me. I'm pushing you away from the fire, but you people insist to jump in the whole fire. People insist. People do a lot of effort because they want to go there. Rasulullah ﷺ said, كُلُّ أُمَّتِي يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا مَنْ أَبَى. Wallahi, this hadith breaks the heart. Really, he said, every single member of Ummati is invited to go to the Jannah. We'll go to the Jannah, except those people who decline the invitation. I invited everyone. I open the door for everyone. Only those people who refuse to go to the Jannah will not go because they refuse. That is their choice. He said, Ya Rasulullah, who is this idiot? Who is this crazy? Who doesn't want to go to the Jannah? He said, simple it is. Man ata'ani dakhala al-Jannah. Wa man asani faqad aba. Whoever obey me will go to Jannah. And whoever doesn't obey me, disobey me, will go to the hellfire. Simple as that. Obey Rasulullah, do not obey your wife, do not obey your community, do not obey your boss, do not obey anyone if they give you an instruction against Rasulullah's instruction. If they tell you right, or if they tell you left, and Rasulullah tells you right, go right. Why? Because Rasulullah is keen to save you, but those people are calling you for Jahannam. Are calling you for Jahannam, subhanallah. كالذي استهوته الشياطين في الأرض حيران له أصحاب يدعونه إلى الهدى أتنا. It is the example of one of us, is just the one who got companions, people that he loved to be around them. They call him, but they are shaitan. They call him to the mislead, to the misguidance. They call him, and Allah called him to the truth. أتنا إلى الهدى. This is the huda. This is the truth. This is the guidance. Come to us, and he's confused which one to follow. Man, I'm gonna lose my job if I don't do that. Man, I'm gonna lose my advantage, my privilege, my card, my this. Lose it. Lose it. What is gonna happen? What is the worst is gonna happen to you? If you lose your deen and earn the whole entire world, is it gonna save you from Jahannam? No. What about if you lose the whole entire world but you earn your deen? You will go to Jannah. You remember I gave you the example before? This man who was given a 4x4 flash, brand new car, and the people give him the car, they said, look, this is your car, drive it. You have plenty of space, you are okay to pick up anything. You have limited seats, you can pick up on the road anyone. But somewhere on the road, we don't know when and where, people are going to stop you and take you out of the car and check inside your car. They will look for something. If you have it, then you passed. If you don't have it with you, you are in a lot of trouble. Are you ready for the challenge? Yes, I'm ready. Jump it in the car, flash, nice, drive smooth, nice road. He keep driving and somebody waved signal to him. Hey man, take me with you. Who are you? Money. Money, of course, come. The front seat. Jump in and then drive a little bit more. Somebody signaled, hey, stop. Can you give me a ride? Who are you? Wife? Yes, come. Have a space. again, somewhere again. Hey, come, yeah, position, prestige, yes, yes, come. Right, children, yeah, come. Friends, entertainment, come. Car is full. Close to the end, somebody is waving, but you know, so weak, so shy. Hey, can you give me a ride? Who are you, my mate? I am Dean, religion. Sorry, I have no space for you in my car. I have no space for Dean and my religion. Okay, just give me, I will just go around and come and pick you up. While he enjoying everything with him in the car, you know, money, wife, children, position, health, everything is there. All of a sudden, people cone on the road, stop, get out of the car. Hey, then he remember, they told me some people are going to get out of the car. Come with us. Where? We'll let you know. Let's check the car. You don't have it. What that? You don't have the religion. This is what we're looking for. The good deed. Yeah, but I have the money. Take it. No, we don't need it. Take my wife. No, we don't need her. Take my children. No. Are we only looking for religion? Okay, just give me a second. I'm just going to go and make a U-turn and pick him up. No. Too late. Too late. Get out. Take you to Jannah. Yeah. This is the example of every one of us. We drive, we enjoy, we move on and on and on. And we're not sure, we're not aware that we're not home. We are not home. Guys, we are not home. This is not our home. We are just here for a very short time. If you compare 50 years, 70 years, 100 years, 1,000 years to infinity, the equation will be zero, nothing. This dunya means nothing to Allah subhanahu. We are not home. I hear the speaker was saying that, look, my teacher explained to me and he said, if you check in a hotel and they give you a room for a night, and then you find yourself in this room and you said, oh man, this is my room now. And you went up to the shop and you purchased paint and furniture, and you start painting the room and replacing the furniture and decorating it. What do you think of me if I start doing that after I check in the hotel for a while? You are crazy, of course. No one does that. Have you seen somebody doing that in a hotel room? Of course not. Why? Because you just check in for a night. Why you are wasting all of your resources? You invest everything for this world. People invest everything for this time. Invest their time, they invest their money, they invest their health, they invest everything they have for this world. For this world. And this is part of the plan. Part of the plan of the Dajjal is to get the people to worship themselves. I worship myself. What does it mean? That I come first and Allah comes next. That is a reality. If you are asleep and the fajr is up and your alarm goes on, what do? I am first. Why? Because what you want is to sleep, isn't it? Right? Because it's comfy and it's good. What does Allah want from you? To wake up and get out of your comfort and go to the masjid and pray. What do you worship here? Who is your master here? Who is your boss? You are your boss. Where is Allah? He's not here anymore. If you really truly believe this is Allah is your boss, is your God, is your authority, you will never ever dare to go back again to sleep. You will wake up and say, man, I have no right to stay, sleep. If you have an option to go for halal, haram and halal, it's not an option. It's not an option, it's one choice. We have no option, it's not an option here. Halal, of course, I can't do something haram. Why? Because inni akhafullah. Inni akhafullah. This is something Shaitan said. Shaitan himself said to the disbeliever in the battle of Badr, that he was joining them in the battle. When he saw the angel, he started making a U-turn and running away. He said, man, come back, come and fight with us. He said, no, inni ara ma la taraun. Inni akhaf Allah, I can see what you people can't see. And he ran away. Inni akhaf, I fear Allah. So this is one of the things that we worship, we start worshiping ourselves. We become first. What we want comes first, not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is up front, on the front line, we will know for sure what to do. We will not be confused. We will have it clear. Look, man, this is what Allah wants. No question asking. I have no other option. I'm a slave of Allah. I worship Allah. I don't worship myself. Most of the human resources, are invented for overwhelm. Tell me, what are the biggest industry in the world? I will tell you, what are the biggest industry that consume most of the resources of the people? Pornography, number one. What that? It's worshipping the body, worshipping the desire. Number two, military, arms, smuggling of weapons. And that's again to worship the ego. People want to be powerful, to overcome other, to control other. Again, it's part of that. You see? And what is the third, you know, biggest industry? It is cosmetics. Again, to make women worship their own body. Cosmetics and all the beauty stuff, you know, operations to enlarge and to make things small and just to play with the creation of Allah. No one is happy with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is happy with what Allah made because Allah couldn't make it right. They want to fix what Allah couldn't made right. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. I heard one of the doctors saying, one of the neurologists saying that if you were able, imagine that you are able to count the grains of sand that cover the face of earth, you will come up with a gigantic number, huge number, I can't read it. And if you were able to count the stars and planets in the whole entire universe, you will come with a gigantic number. But this number will be bigger than the first number of the grain of sand. And if you were able, imagine you are able to count the electric signals that one single brain cell sent to another cell, you will come with a gigantic number, and this number will even be bigger than the first and second one. One cell sends signals to the next cell in the brain, the number of signal, electric signals between one cell and the next one, how many? Is way bigger than the number of all the grains of sand that exist and cover the face of earth. This is just two cells in the brain that has millions of cells. What that? صُنْعَ اللَّهِ الَّذِي أَتْقَنَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. This is the creation of Allah that perfected everything that He has created. And people come today, they want to instill into our mind that what Allah has made is wrong. And we have to redo it again because it wasn't right. What does it mean? What is the message behind that? Is to make the people worship themselves, worship their own bodies and their own desires. It is all about what I want, what I feel like to do. Allah is not there anymore. His authority is not there anymore. That is why what is not legal become legal. What was shameful becomes a pride now. What was prohibited becomes recommended today. Why? Because Allah's authority is not there anymore. It's not in the scene. It is us. It is our own desires. It is our own body. And this is to make the world, or to prepare the world for the arrival of Dajjal. And when Dajjal present himself to the people, ugly, awar, one single-eyed, curly hair, short guy, super ugly person. But he would say to the people, I am your God. They're going to believe him. Don't you see in the movies, in the American movies especially, images of creatures or, you know, robots, they look extremely ugly, right? They have no face. They look really ugly, but they have superpower. And they call themselves as gods. Have you watched these movies? They are there. What that? To prepare the people psychologically, when the Dajjal comes up, this ugly face, ugly feature, and tell the people, I am your God. The people will still believe in him and trust him. I am not actually watching, but have you seen in the Star Wars? There was an ugly creature, short one, like, you know? And he was the source of wisdom. You see, I'm talking to the young ones, right? He was one of the amazing guys in the whole entire series. What for? Because the Dajjal is going to be short. And he will look ugly like that, big ears, super ugly, but the people is going to trust him. The wisdom is going to come from him. When he says, this is the Jannah, they will jump in the Jannah. This is the hellfire, they will jump in the hellfire. Why? Because now they are prepared to believe in that. So brothers, I take a lot of your time and my time as well. One thing I want to finish with, please take it really seriously. We are not in a position of relaxation and taking things easy. We are almost about to start the beginning of the end. And we have to be extremely careful. And the only way of salvation to be safe is to hold firm to this deen. And to make sure that you follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion. And don't listen to any call that tell, come and join us. We are the best of Muslims. I said, look, the best of Muslims are Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions radiallahu anhum. Ma ana alayhi wa ashabi. And if people are not happy with you, it's not a big deal for me. As long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy with me, this is all what I'm looking for. This is what all I'm looking for. Allah is number one in my life, in my priority. He's my authority. He is my boss. He is my creator. I only obey him before I listen or obey anyone else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to the truth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qualify all of us to the Jannah in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azab al-nar. Rabbana ati nufusana taqwaha wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha anta waliyuha mawlaya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma aghfir warham wa tajawaz amma ta'lam innaka antal azz al-akram. Allahumma aafina wa afu anna wa tub alayna wa samihna ya arhamar rahimin. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. السلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.